Hello students, today we'll have a lecture on nutritive value of common food items. Yesterday we have discussed the classification and cereals and pulses. Classification by nutritive value, we have already seen this: cereals and millets, pulses, vegetables, nuts and oil seeds, fruits, animal foods, fats and oils, sugar and jaggery, condiments and spices, and miscellaneous groups. So I already told you we have discussed the cereals and millets and pulses. So today we are going to see the vegetables, nuts and oil seeds, fruits, animal food, fats and oils, sugar and jaggery, condiments and spices, and the miscellaneous groups. Vegetables, they are classified as protective foods. They contain vitamins and minerals. They are poor sources of proteins, but there are certain vegetables like green peas and beans which are very good source of proteins. We know that vegetables have large amount of water. They have low energy and protein content, and they have very good amount of dietary fiber. We know that vegetables could be divided into three main groups: the green leafy vegetables, the roots and tubers, and others. Green leafy vegetables. The most common examples are palak, amaranth, cabbage, and fenugreek. We should know that the darker the green leaves, the greater is the nutritive value. They are good sources of carotenes, calcium, iron, vitamin C, riboflavin, folic acid, and few other micronutrients, then lysine, but they deficit in sulfur containing amino acids. Though they have calcium and iron, the green leafy vegetables are the bioavailability of them is low because of presence of oxalates. And a very important point about green leafy vegetable is, because of the low calorific value, it is important in the diet of obese people. Few images of these vegetables. So this is amaranth, spinach, also known as palak, and it's a good source of iron. Fenugreek, so we have fenugreek leaves and seeds. Again, very important, the fenugreek seeds have a lot of fiber, which is important for the diabetic patients. So around 10 to 12 grams of roasted powdered fenugreek seed could be had in a day. So it could be divided 5 grams in the morning. So it could, this powder could be mixed in any of the menus. Cabbage. So the nutritive values, we can see that all these vegetables, they give us good amount of vitamins and minerals. Especially the amaranth and fenugreek, they are having high amount of calcium. And they do give less of proteins and carbohydrates. Roots and tubers. In this group, we have potato, sweet potato, carrot, onion, radish, and colocasia. They are like few of them, like potato and sweet potato. They are very good source of carbohydrates. Though they are poor in proteins, minerals, and vitamins, carrots are rich in beta carotene, and the daily allowance here is 50 to 60 grams. Potatoes, radish, sweet potato, yam, carrots, onions, colocasia. So we have seen these leaves. We use these leaves also to prepare vegetable, to prepare curries. But even the roots are used. Okay. So about roots and tubers. So we can see they give us a good amount of carbohydrates, especially the potatoes and sweet potatoes, and the topaika, which there are various preparations of it, that we can prepare chips also. So you can see that they are giving us good carbohydrate. There are few other vegetables like brinjal, tomato, cauliflower. They all provide us a lot of variety. Otherwise, just having roots and tubers or green leafy vegetables, so this doesn't provide a lot of variety. So all these vegetables, they do have, they are good sources of minerals and vitamins. And the cluster bean, the drumsticks, green mango, they have a good amount of iron. And we need around 60 to 70 gram of these vegetables. Pumpkin, lemon, other vegetables. So we can see that vegetables like beans provide a good amount of proteins, and we have cluster beans that is providing good amount of minerals like calcium. Nuts and oil seeds, they have a good amount of fat and they have good quality protein, but the quality is not equal to the protein quality of the animal origin. They are good sources of vitamin and minerals like calcium, phosphorus and iron. They are rich in essential fatty acids. Oil cake is something that is got when the oil is being extracted from these oil seeds or the nuts. Almonds, cashew nut, pistachio or pistas, raisins, so you know these are dried grapes, walnut, dates, dry coconut, groundnuts. You could be asked to write the nutritive value per 100 gram of this food item, that is proteins 26.7%, fat 40.1%, energy 567 kilocalories, and it is rich in niacin, and the other minerals what it is rich in is iron, calcium and phosphorus. Improper storage results into infestation by a fungus that is Aspergillus. The fungus produces mycotoxins called aflatoxins, which are hepatotoxic and carcinogenic. Consumption of infested food causes aflatoxicosis. So how can you prevent this? Is ensure proper storage after thorough drying. During storage, moisture content should be kept below 10%. Avoid consuming infested nuts. Okay. So this is a table related to your nuts. So we have different nuts: almond, cashew nut, pista or the pistachio, walnut, groundnut and dry coconut. So this table is showing you the nutritive value of all of these, that is the kilocalories per 100 gram, the fat and the proteins, okay, and any other special characteristic it has. So we can see that almonds, that is badam, gives 655 kilocalories and 58.9 gram of fat, 20.8 gram of protein, and it's a very good source of iron. The cashew nuts or the kazu, it has 596 kilocalories and 46.9 grams of fat, 21.2 grams of protein. Again, it's a good source of iron. Coming to pista, it gives 626 kilocalories per 100 gram, 53.5 grams of fat, 19.8 gram of protein. It is the richest in iron among all nuts. Walnut, 687 kilocalories, 64.5 grams of fat, 15.6 grams of protein. It's rich in polyunsaturated fatty acids. Groundnuts, 567 kilocalories, 40.1 gram of fat, 25.3 grams of protein,
and it is particularly rich in niacin. So we had already discussed it, that groundnut could be had by people who are mainly eating jowar. And dry coconut, it gives 662 kilocalories, 62.3 grams of fat, 6.8 grams of proteins. It's rich in iron, contains vitamin C, and predominantly the fatty acids are of saturated type.
Mustard seeds, linseeds, Niger seeds, safflower seeds, sesame seeds or the till, sunflower seeds. The nutritive value of these nuts and oil seeds. So coming to oil seeds, so we know groundnut we will discuss separately. Linseed, mustard, Niger. So among them, one important point is with the mustard seed, we need to know that it can be contaminated with Arjumon seeds, and I'll just show you how they look and how you need to differentiate them. So what we can see with these oil seeds is they give us very good energy, they give us good amount of proteins, minerals, and they are good source of calcium and phosphorus. Most of them, so majority you can see the mustard seeds is also giving us good calcium and phosphorus. Then we do have few other seeds, that is the gingelly seeds, which is giving very good amount of calcium. So just go through this table and you know all the nutritive value of these oil seeds and nuts. Now the dietary sources of essential fatty acids, we'll just you know why we are discussing all these points here in the other slides. So linoleic acid, we should know that safflower, corn oil, the sunflower oil, soya bean oil, sesame oil, groundnut oil, mustard oil, palm oil, they do give us, but the amount is varying. So highest you can see the safflower oil, that's giving us the highest amount of linoleic acid. Okay, then we have the arachidonic acid, again the sources meat, eggs and milk, we will discuss that. Then we have linoleic acid by soya bean oil and leafy greens. Then we have eicosa pentanoic acid by fish oil. So I've just told you all these from where we are getting these essential fatty acids. So the next important slide here, okay, just don't go into much of these details, but know few important ones, like the saturated fatty acids is high in the coconut and the palm oil, butter and all those. So usually you're going to have less of these saturated fatty acids. Then monounsaturated fatty acids, you can see that we have a good amount of these in the rice bran, the sesame, okay, around 41%, and then we have in the groundnuts also. Okay, then coming to the other ones, linoleic acid, okay. So you can see the highest amount here, around 75, again with the safflower oil. Okay, then we have the alpha linoleic acid, which is, you can see again, highest with the mustard. So highest with the flock seed or the linseed. So again, a very important point. So you need to choose these oils compared to the saturated fatty acids. Choice of cooking oil. In vegetable oils, we can have combination of two oils. So this combination could be oil containing linoleic acid and oil containing both linoleic and alpha linoleic acid. And it could be any of these following combinations. Then we could have oil containing high linoleic acid plus oil containing moderate or low linoleic acid. So again, any of these combinations could be tried. Now coming to the others, that is, we need to limit the use of butter and ghee, that is the oils from animal origin. As we know, they are rich in saturated fatty acids, so we should limit their use. Then we need to avoid use of partially hydrogenated vegetable oils for cooking. Then we can replace these partially hydrogenated vegetable oils by other oils. Like usually for frying, we can use oils which have higher thermal stability, like palm oil, palm oil, then sesame, then rice bran, cotton seed. We can use them in combination or singly. The oils could be made at home or commercially available.
Groundnut oil, commenting on the quality of fat, that is, groundnut oil is high in monounsaturated fatty acids. And the other questions are, what is its role in nutritional rehabilitation? The multipurpose food that is used in National Nutritional Program is prepared by mixing 75% of groundnut flour and 25% of roasted red gram flour. So we had already discussed this in the red gram. Okay. So among all the nuts, which one has the highest content of iron? So moving to other questions related to nuts are, the pista or the pistachio has 14 milligrams per 100 gram of iron.
What is oil cake? In case of some oil seeds, the residue after extraction of oil can be used as an acceptable food which is rich in protein. Example, groundnut. Archimonde seeds. This I told you before, this could be a contamination in the mustard seeds. See, the size looks like mustard seeds, but the other image, what you can see, is a very close view of it. So here you can make out that the surface in Archimonde seeds is irregular and you have spikes. So you would be, if this is kept as a spotter, you would be given hand lens you could see the spikes which are present, and you could differentiate if it is mustard seed or it is the Archimonde seed. So the very important thing is, it contains a toxin, sanguinarin, and consumption of this adulterated seed could cause epidemic dropsy. Fruits. They have this protective role. They are good sources of vitamins and minerals. A very important point about fruits is, they could be had raw and fresh. About nutritive values, they do provide vitamin C, carotene. They provide sodium and potassium. And very important, the sitafal or the custard apple, it's rich in calcium. Now, the other important thing group is, fruits could be divided into the fresh ones and we have the dried fruits. The dried fruits are good source of calcium and iron. They contain a variety of organic acids. Comparatively, they are the low energy foods. Then fruits like guava, they do have a substance called pectins, by which we could prepare jellies out of them. Then they do have cellulose, which helps in the normal bowel movement. The daily intake of fruits, you can say, we need around 85 grams of fruits. A few images of fruits: grapes, guava, mango, orange, very good source of vitamin C, papaya, vitamin A, sitafal or the custard apple, I told you, good source of calcium, apples, banana, amla or the Indian gooseberry. So amla is a very rich source of vitamin C. So about nutritive value of some common fruits, we can see that banana and sitafal get high calories, and calcium, we get a good amount of calcium from amla. Then we have orange, grapes, and sitafal. We have a high amount of iron from sitafal again. The yellow colored fruits, mango, orange, papaya, they give a lot of carotene, and highest source of vitamin C we can see from amla. And about dry fruits, you can see that they give us a lot of calories, all the dry fruits. Almonds have high amount of calcium, and almonds and cashew nuts have good amount of iron in them. About animal foods, we'll discuss about these animal foods like egg, milk, meat, and fish.
The next part is eggs. So the nutritive value per 100 gram is proteins 13.3 grams, fat 13.3 grams, carbohydrates is almost nil, energy 173 kilocalories per 100 gram. It provides all the vitamins except vitamin C. The nutritive value in terms of content per egg, which could weigh roughly around 16 grams, is proteins 6 grams, fat 6 grams, no carbohydrates, and energy 70 kilocalories. Why egg protein is called the reference protein? Egg protein contains all the 9 essential amino acids and in the right proportion. The net protein utilization of egg protein is 100%. Is it rich in which group of vitamins? So egg is rich in both fat and water soluble vitamins except vitamin C. What is the recommended method for consuming eggs and why? The recommended method is to cook the egg before consumption. This is because of these following reasons. Raw egg white is not assimilated in human gut. Raw egg contains avidin, which prevents absorption of biotin by the body, and cooking destroys avidin. Mention the criteria of a good egg. So you should know that there are different tests to do this, and the most important one and commonly done is the water density test. The fresh egg sinks to the bottom of water and lies on the side, horizontal to the surface of the water. Lesser fresh eggs sink but stand at an angle to the bottom. Old and non-fresh eggs, they float on water and should be discarded. This is because as the egg ages, the air sac inside it grows larger and makes it lighter.
Nutritive value of meat, fish, and eggs. We can see that about meat, every 100 gram we get 21 grams of protein, 3 grams of fat, and 1.1 gram of minerals. About fish, gives us about 19.5 grams of protein, 2.4 grams of fat, and 1.5 gram of mineral. And egg of a hen gives 13.3 grams of protein, 13.3 gram of fat, and 1 gram of mineral. And liver of goat gives us 20 grams of protein, 3 gram fat, and 1.3 grams of minerals. So you should know that two large eggs without shell weigh around 100 grams.
Next, milk. So this is a table to show you the nutritional value or the nutrition content of these different type of milk. Okay, we have cow milk, buffalo milk, and human milk. So all these, for every 100 ml of cow's milk, we have protein 3.2 grams, fat 4.1 gram, lactose 4.4 grams, calcium 120 milligrams, and it gives us a calorie of 67 kilocalories per 100 ml. Now moving on with the buffalo milk. Buffalo milk gives 6.5 grams of protein per 100 ml, 4.3 grams of fat, 5.1 gram of lactose, 210 milligrams of calcium, and it gives 117 kilocalories of energy. Human milk, that is 100 ml of human milk, gives us 1.1 gram of protein, 3.4 grams of fat, 7.4 grams of lactose, 28 milligrams of calcium, and totally 65 kilocalories of energy. The other important things are, what is pasteurization? Pasteurization is heating of milk to such temperatures and for such time period which is sufficient to destroy pathogens present in the milk but leads to minimal change in the composition, flavor and nutritive value of milk. So this is a definition which is given by WHO. So we have different methods of pasteurization, and the three important ones among them are Holder method, that is the VAT method, the high temperature short time method, then we have the ultra high temperature method. Now we'll see these methods one by one. The Holder method, here it is that you heat the milk for a temperature of 63 to 66 degrees Celsius for at least 30 minutes. Then it is quickly cooled to 5 degrees Celsius. The high temperature short time method, it's rapidly heated to 72 degrees Celsius and held not for less than 15 seconds, then it is rapidly cooled for to 4 degrees Celsius. Then we have ultra high temperature method. Here we heat the milk to 125 degrees Celsius. This method, we have two stages. The second is done under high pressure. Okay, so this temperature that is attained, that is 125 degrees Celsius, which is held for few seconds, then it is rapidly cooled and then bottled. We have different tests of pasteurized milk, that is the phosphatase test, the standard plate count and the coliform count. Then you could be asked questions like comment on the type of proteins that are present in milk. So milk proteins are complete. They contain all the essential amino acids. The main protein in milk is casein. This is present in combination with calcium as calcium caseogenate. The other milk products are lactalbumin and lactoglobulin. Human milk proteins have higher amount of tryptophan as compared to animal milk. The net protein utilization of milk is 75. Now you could be asked a question to compare and comment on the different type of fats that are present in milk. The fat content varies from 3.4 grams in human milk to 8.8 grams in buffalo milk. Human milk contains greater percentage of linoleic acid and oleic acid. Milk fat is present in the form of fine particles and hence easily digestible. Milk fat is rich in vitamins A and D. Why is milk called an ideal food? Milk is a good source of protein, fat, sugars, vitamins and minerals. Proteins of milk contain all the essential amino acids. Milk fat is present in the form of fine particles and hence it is easily digestible. Milk fats are rich in vitamin A and D. Minerals like calcium, phosphorus, sodium, potassium, magnesium, cobalt, copper, iodine are present in milk. And vitamins, that is, milk is a source of all vitamins except vitamin C. Okay. Few other questions related to milk are advantages of breastfeeding. So breastfeeding is hygienic. It is available to the baby at the correct temperature. It fully meets the nutritional requirement of the infant for the initial 4 to 6 months of life. It is easily digestible for the baby. It contains antimicrobial factors such as macrophages, IgA, anti-streptococcal factor, lysozyme and lactoferrin. It promotes bonding between the infant and the mother. Breastfed infants have been found to have the following advantages. They have lower mortality, lesser tendency for obesity. They have higher intelligence quotient, that is higher IQ. Prevention of neonatal hypocalcemia and hypomagnesemia. And the other questions are, what is the main difference between cow's milk and human milk? Human milk protein contains higher amount of tryptophan and sulfur containing amino acids. What is toned milk? Toned milk is a blend of natural milk and reconstituted milk in fixed proportions. Natural milk 1 part, water 1 part, and skim milk powder 1/8 part. Its composition is similar to that of the cow's milk.
Fats and oils. Oils are liquid at room temperature. We know that fats are good source of energy and fat soluble vitamins. They are poor source of essential fatty acids. Then usually fats and oils of vegetable origin, we know that they are polyunsaturated fatty acids, and oils of vegetable origin, they usually have less amount of vitamin A and D except the red palm oil. This is an image of ghee.
Next, we have ghee. The calorie content is 900 kilocalories per 100 gram. So why is it not recommended for obese and cardiac patient is, it's because ghee has a very high content of saturated fat. And the other related questions are, does it have any advantage over vegetable oil? Yes, it is rich in vitamin A and D, and vegetable oils are poor in both of these vitamins. Is there any vegetable fat which is rich in vitamin A? It is the red palm oil, which is rich in carotene. Vanaspati ghee is made from vegetable oil and is fortified with vitamin A and D.
Vanaspati ghee.
Next we have vanaspati ghee. How is it different from vegetable oil? So vanaspati ghee is made synthetically from vegetable oil by hydrogenation. It contains predominantly saturated fatty acids and like vegetable oils. It has a high content of trans fatty acids. It has better shelf life. It is fortified with vitamins A and D. And the other question is, what is hydrogenation? So hydrogenation is a process. So usually in this process, the vegetable oils are hydrogenated in the presence of a catalyst under optimum condition of temperature and pressure. The unsaturated fatty acids are converted into saturated fatty acids, and the liquid oil changes into a semi-solid or a solid fat. Now, with this procedure, we have certain disadvantages and advantages. The disadvantages are, the unsaturated fatty acids gets converted into saturated fat, which is harmful. Trans fatty acids are produced, which are more atherogenic than even saturated fatty acids. The advantages, hydrogenation improves the shelf life of vegetable oil. The solid ghee-like consistency is preferred for certain types of cooking in India. So what are trans fatty acids? Trans fatty acids are geometric isomers of naturally occurring cis unsaturated fatty acids. They are produced by partial hydrogenation of polyunsaturated fatty acids in vegetable oil. Repeated reheating of oil for frying can produce these trans fatty acids. Now, why are trans fatty acids harmful? They raise the plasma level of low density lipids or the low the LDL cholesterol. They reduce the level of HDL cholesterol.
Butter.
Next, we have butter. The nutritive value is energy, 729 kilocalories per 100 grams. The predominant type of fatty acid content is the saturated fatty acid. The other nutrients which are present in it are carotene and vitamin D.
Sugar and jaggery. So, they usually got from sugarcane. And sugar, it is mainly the sucrose is present. And it's rich in carotene and iron. Usually, this is got in jaggery because of the process of preparation. And about honey, it is 75% sugar, mostly the fructose and glucose is present. Jaggery, sugar. So again, this is the nutritional content of sugar and jaggery. Jaggery, again, we have jaggery from different origins. Mainly what we have here is the one from sugarcane. Okay. So you can see that here in jaggery, the carbohydrates and sugars are high. And the energy that is got every 100 gram is also very high compared to the other food items. And it's again in jaggery we can see that the calcium content is also higher. Condiments and spices, the most important thing about them is they enhance the palatability of the food. They stimulate the appetite. It has a carminative property, so it aids in digestion. But excessive consumption of them may lead to peptic ulcers. So images of spices and condiments are, one is the asafoetida. So you should know that it is, you commonly call it hing. Cardamom, usually used for flavor. Cinnamon. Cloves. Cumin. Nutmeg, pepper, turmeric, chili, garlic, ginger. Now, this is an image of the nutritive value of all these condiments and spices. So just go through this chart. Usually remember that it is they do give a small amount of energy, and mainly it is the minerals which is there. You can see that they have good, they are good source of calcium, especially you can see cumin seeds, that is the jeera, what it is usually known as. And similarly, you can see a few other things like coriander seeds, again giving good amount of carbohydrate and energy, and having good quantity of calcium in it and phosphorus. Miscellaneous group, we have beverages, coffee, tea and coca. We have soft drinks and alcoholic beverages. So about coffee, tea and coca, coffee gives 1.8 grams of protein, 2.2 grams of fat and 17.8 grams of carbohydrate, around 98 kilocalories. About tea, it gives 0.9 grams of protein, 1.1 gram of fat and 16.4 grams of carbohydrate. totally around 79 kilocalories. Coca, 7.2 grams of protein, 8.8 gram of fat, 26.2 grams of carbohydrate, 213 kilocalories. Alcoholic beverages. So, they are beer, whiskey, rum, gin, and arak. Alcoholic content again varies from 5 to 40, 45%. So the lower one is in beer, and we have higher 40 to 45% in the other drinks. Then alcohol supplies about 7 kilocalories per gram. Now moving on to other ones, that is vinegar. We have natural vinegar, what we can get from fermentation of fruits, malt and molasses. And then we can even have synthetic vinegar, which should not be harmful if it's free from lead, copper, arsenic or any other mineral acids. But according to Prevention of Food Adulteration Act, the word synthetic has to be on the it has to be labeled. So in short, about the foods from which we can get energy is rice, wheat, okay, and the dry fruits. Then the other vegetable oils, ghee and vanaspati, all these give good amount of energy. For proteins, it is pulses, nuts and oil seeds, and the animal foods, okay, fish, meat and poultry, and milk and milk products. Then beta carotene, we have leafy vegetables, we have in other vegetables, we have pumpkin, green chilies, carrot, fruits, we have ripe mango and papaya. Folic acid, again we can get it from green leafy vegetables like amaranth, mint, spinach. Then we have pulses like Bengal gram, black gram, green gram and red gram. Then a few oil seeds like soya bean, we get folic acid. Then vitamin A, we get from fats and edible oils like butter, ghee. Then riboflavin, we get them from cereals and the other products like bajra, barley, ragi. Then in pulses, Bengal gram, black gram, they do provide riboflavin. Then we get it from green leafy vegetables, nuts and oil seeds, then few spices. In fruits, we get it from papaya. Then from animal sources, that is milk, poultry, milk and milk products, meat. Okay. In milk products, it is the skim milk powder, whole milk powder. Then iron, we know it's from a few green leafy vegetables. And then we have calcium from ragi, sitafal. Okay, then we have different nuts, then animal sources. Vitamin C, mainly it is amla, and then we have other fruits, lemon, which provide us vitamin C. About fiber, it is the cereals, okay, cereals and pulses, that is wheat, jawar, bajra, ragi, maize, okay, and the fenugreek seeds, I told you. So to summarize, today we have discussed about different vegetables. We have seen that's classified into green leafy vegetables, giving a lot of fiber, minerals and vitamins. And then we seen nuts and oil seeds, which again, the nuts are giving us lot of calories, the oil seeds, fats and calories, good amount of proteins even. Then we have seen fruits, again protective food, giving us lot of vitamins and minerals. Then we have seen animal foods giving high proteins. Then the others, fats and oils, we have seen how we are going to use oils, the different combinations in vegetable oils, and how we need to limit the use of butter and ghee, and less or no use of trans fatty acids are the partially hydrogenated vegetable oils. Sugar and jaggery, we know that from where it is got and what type of sugar or what type of glucose it has, then different condiments and spices, usually for flavor and giving a lot of vitamins and minerals also. Then miscellaneous groups, we have seen about different beverages, alcoholic beverages, then we have seen about vinegar, then in other than that the soft drinks, then in beverages we have seen about the different content of tea, coffee and coca. Thank you. Thank you.